I'm going to be talking about some stuff which is joint work with Johannes Karmesin. And I'd like to start by talking about this quote from Harvey Friedman. So in this quote, he gives a picture of sort of a ZF foundation for mathematics as something like this. You have the cumulative hierarchy. And in the first few levels of the cumulative hierarchy, you find things like the reals and the power set of the reals and basically all the stuff that gets used for actual mathematics. And then sort of higher up here in the cumulative hierarchy, what you have is just junk that is given to you by the rules of the set theory. And so what he says is, when we examine the classical set-theoretic foundations of mathematics, we see that the only sets that play a role are sets of restricted type, these ones down here. At the risk of understatement, only sets of rank less than omega plus omega. No notion of set of arbitrary transfinite type, or even notions of set obtained by some definite iteration beyond omega plus omega of the power set operation is relevant as of now to mathematical practice, or even understood by mathematicians. So this should be a quote which gives hope to people who want a type theoretic foundation for mathematics. Because what you can do with type theory all lives down in this very low part of the cumulative hierarchy. And so if you want to give a foundation for mathematics, for working mathematics as practiced by mathematicians, you have to hope that it all lives down here in the area which you can actually capture with type theory. Right. So Friedman gave this quote at the start of a paper where he discussed a principle which he thought kind of maybe it could be something like this. It could be something which appears in actual mathematics, but where this junk is relevant. That's the principle of determinacy, which I'll talk about later. But mostly so far, this principle has just been of set theoretic interest. And what I want to talk about today is how this principle is also relevant for some much more concrete mathematics. So, first of all, let's talk about determinacy principles. So the setup here is that you have a game, and this game takes place in a particular context, which is given by a set X and a subset of the set of sequences of elements of X. And now the game is played between two players, player one and player two, as follows. Player one picks an element of X. Then player two picks another element of X. Player one picks again an element of X, and they keep going back and forth like this forever. After infinitely many moves, they've generated between them a sequence of elements of the set X. And now player one wins if the sequence that they've generated is in the set Psi of sequences, which was fixed in advance. And otherwise, player two wins. Okay. So because in any play of the game, at least one of the players wins, if this were a finite game, it would be clear that at least one of the two players has a winning strategy. But because this is an infinite game, this is no longer so clear. And so we have simply a name for that, that if at least one of the players does have a winning strategy in this game, then the game is called determined. Okay. And there are a few basic facts about determinacy which explain why this idea has been of so much interest for set theorists. So firstly, if you assume the axiom of choice, then you can produce some set psi such that the game corresponding to psi on a set of size 2, so psi is a set of sequences from a two-element set, such that this game is not determined. And this is just a kind of a normal transfinite recursion argument to get this kind of statement. But if your set is topologically nice enough, then the game will be determined. So, for example, if the set psi is an open set, then we know that for any play through the whole game in which the first player wins, there's some finite initial segment of that, such that it's guaranteed after that finite initial segment that the first player is going to win. And now if the first player has no winning strategy, then the second player can play in such a way as to ensure that the first player never gains a winning strategy, and in particular that you never reach a point from which it's guaranteed that the first player will win, and therefore in which the second player necessarily wins. So if the first player doesn't have a winning strategy, then the second player does. In fact, you have determinacy not just for open sets, but for a larger class of topologically nice sets called Borel sets. Just to remind you, this is the smallest collection of sets containing all the open sets, and which is closed under complementation and countable unions, countable intersections. Yes?
Sorry, I'm not sure if this is folklore, the first theorem, or was it already proved by Banach and Mazur in mid-1920s, that the existence of non-determined games under axiom of choice? I thought that this is... this can be pinpointed, it's not just folklore. Who proved it first?
Okay, I'm happy to accept that. Thank you.
And the ambient theory for the statement that you are making is Zermelo-Frankel, right?
Right, I'm giving the set-theoretic point of view on determinacy at the moment. Right. So, yes. So Martin showed that if your set psi is a Borel set, then the game that you get from it is always going to be a determined game. But it had already been shown by Friedman in this paper that I quoted earlier that you can't prove this principle, Borel determinacy, just in Zermelo set theory. In fact, he showed something a little stronger. He showed that in order to prove Borel determinacy, you need to have a strong enough formalism to be able to iterate the power set operation uncountably many times. And so in particular, what's relevant for us today is that Borel determinacy is not a principle you can prove in a type theoretic foundation.
So by Zermelo set theory, you mean ZF minus replacement?
Yes. Right. And so this says if you want to have determinacy for Borel sets, then you need to have sort of fairly large stuff going on. You need to have enough replacement to give you at least everything that ZFC is giving you. There are then various other statements which have been proved more recently relating determinacy to large cardinal statements.
To understand this, so is it about replacement or is it about choice here? I mean,
replacement.
It's about replacement. I see.
Yes, it's about having enough replacement. Uh-huh. Yeah. So, yes, if you have enough large cardinals, as you assume stronger and stronger large cardinal principles, you can deduce from them stronger and stronger determinacy principles. And to some extent, there are equivalences between these large cardinal and determinacy principles. And somewhere towards the top of this hierarchy of correspondences is this theorem from Woodin, which says that the statement that actually every game is determined, of course, as we've seen, this contradicts choice, so we're just working in ZF here. But every game is determined, that this statement is actually equiconsistent with a fairly strong large cardinal principle, namely that there are infinitely many so-called Woodin cardinals. Right. So that I don't look silly for the people who actually understand this stuff, I should say, in most of the correspondences that are happening here, you don't work with games on a set of size 2, but with games over the natural numbers. And that's sort of a natural place to look for the correspondences. But here up at the top, because we're looking at basically every subset, those become equivalent principles again. And for this talk, it'll be games where each choice is just between two options, which are relevant. Okay. I should also say, this is just a quick sketch. I think Philip Welch will be saying more about this in his talk this afternoon. Right, so now I want to talk about where these kinds of ideas came up in an apparently unrelated branch of mathematics called topological infinite graph theory. So I guess you remember a graph is given by a set of vertices together with some edges joining some pairs of these vertices. And for this talk, I'm going to allow the graph to be infinite, like this graph here. And it was noticed a while ago that there are a lot of questions in infinite graph theory which come from statements in finite graph theory. You take a statement about finite graphs, and then you just replace the word finite by infinite wherever it appears, which somehow, when you generalize them in this way, become either trivial or nonsensical, or they just don't seem to be what you want to get at. For example, there are a lot of statements about when it is that you have a so-called Hamilton cycle in a graph. That's a cycle, some kind of closed curve following the edges of the graph, which goes through all the vertices of the graph. And these things would seem to suggest that in this graph, we ought to have a Hamilton cycle, but this graph is infinite. I mean, there's no hope of finding a cycle that goes through all the vertices in this graph. And as an attempt to fix these sorts of things, people tried to invent various notions of infinite cycle through a graph. So here you might say, look, in this graph, we can make an infinite cycle going through all the vertices if we go off along the top in this direction towards infinity, and then come back from infinity and go off now this way, and then come back in along the top, right? To infinity and back, precisely. And now the question would be, how do we really express this idea of going to infinity and back? We need an idea of adding some points at infinity, which correspond to ways that you could go off to infinity through the graph, and a notion of a kind of a loop which is allowed to go through some of those points. And so the idea, which was invented to capture the notion of a way of going to infinity through a graph, was the notion of ends. So an obvious thing to try. If you want to capture a notion of how to get to infinity, is to look at rays in the graph, a ray being a one-way infinite path. But of course, we want to say that these two rays are going off to infinity in the same direction, whereas this one is going off in a different direction. And the way we capture that is by saying, look, between these two rays, there are infinitely many disjoint paths, which somehow witness that they're going off in a way that the graph recognizes as the same. But you can't find infinitely many disjoint paths through this graph from this ray going across to this ray. And so we say these are going in different directions. And now we simply define these directions as equivalence classes of such rays. And we call such a thing an end. And now we can say, look, you can go along a ray to an end and then come back along a different ray from the same end. We allow that as a thing that you can do on your infinite cycles. And this gets you some of the way But there are still cases where this doesn't seem to have quite got the right notion. One of which is a graph where we take this sort of so-called double ladder and then stick on infinitely many ladders along here. Because now we still think there should be a Hamilton cycle, namely this one. One that, where shall I start? Let's start here. Go off to infinity in this direction, come back, then go off to infinity here, come back, go to infinity here, come back, and keep doing that infinitely many times. And so then after that infinitely many times, you're at infinity over here, and so you can come back this way. And so Reinhard Diestel tried to sort of formalize a notion of infinite cycle using this sort of method where you say, okay, maybe you look at n's and then n's in the space of, sorry, n's within the graph where you've added some n's to capture this sort of behavior, and then you iterate that over the ordinals or something. But ultimately, he had to give up on that and move to a topological description. And the reason is graphs of this sort of a shape. So here, there are an awful lot of different ways to go to infinity through this graph. The graph branches a bit like a binary tree. And so the collection of ends here around the outside, there are uncountably many of them arranged like a Cantor set. And nevertheless, in this graph, it looks like there should be some Hamilton cycle going all the way around the outside here, right? Going through all of these ends. But the way that you would express this, and the way that this was formalized, is that you simply formally add these ends as topological points at infinity to your graph. And now your notion of cycle will be a copy of the unit circle, a topological copy of the unit circle in the graph you get after formally adding all of those points. Okay. And for a graph G, which is, so for this talk I'm working in a slightly simpler context of locally finite graphs. That just means at any vertex there are only finitely many edges incident with that vertex. Okay, so given such a graph, we can define a topological space by formally adding all of the ends as points at infinity. And now this really worked. So for a whole lot of statements from finite graph theory, it now became true that if you replace finite by infinite, but also replace cycle by topological circle in this space and path by topological path through this space, then these statements become true. I don't want to give a survey of that. Instead, what I want to do is to focus on one particular very fundamental question which arises sort of whenever you try to generalize theorems into this context. The issue is you have some infinite graph, and perhaps you're trying to build some cycle or some path for some purpose. But you already have used part of the graph for some other purpose. And so really now you would like to be able to build a path from somewhere to somewhere else in the graph, but only going through some subspace of the topological space. And it's normally very easy to show that these subspaces are connected, but what you want is not connectedness, but path connectedness. You want to find an actual topological path going from left to right. And so this theorem is therefore very useful, that if the subspace you want to do this in is a closed subspace, then as soon as it's connected, it's already path connected. And it was hoped for quite a while, that something stronger might be true, that any connected subspace might already be path connected. But this was shown to be false by Agalos-Georgakopoulos in 2007. And his counterexample is a very convoluted construction, and I think I won't talk about how he did it, but it will follow from some of the things I explain later that this statement is false. Okay. And the question, therefore, becomes how much of this can we salvage? Right? Can we get some bigger, nice collection of subspaces for which it's guaranteed that if they're connected, then they're already path connected?
Sorry, just to clarify, so both the theorem and the counterexample, they are obtained in the absence of choice, right? This is on the base of pure ZF or ZFC.
This, I think you need some, maybe, so if you have a locally finite graph, then you can enumerate the edges, but I think you would have to have a fixed enumeration in order to actually get these things without choice. Yes.
Can you say how you add the endpoints? Are they discretely separated?
Right.
For every path, you add one endpoint, or?
Yeah, I didn't want to go into that because it's not so exciting. But what you do is, if you have your graph.
Okay, everything which.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay, if you have a graph, if you have a graph and you consider some way to divide the vertices of the graph up into two parts such that there are only finitely many edges going across.
Then they will have different endpoints.
Then any ray has to eventually decide which side of this thing it lives on, right? And if I have two rays in the same end, then they both make the same decision. So that means that each end lies on properly on one side of one of these cuts. And now we define the basic open sets around this end to be sets of the form one side of one of these cuts together with finite open, well, I don't need finite, together with open intervals along each of these finitely many edges and together with all the other ends which lie on this side of this cut. That's how the topology is determined. Okay. Right. Okay. Yes. So first I'd like to explain, perhaps in a more understandable way than with this construction of Georgakopoulos, why this conjecture is false. And here I've prepared in advance a graph where all of this will happen. So you can see that this graph is built up by alternating two different kinds of structure in a binary tree. Here we have this kind of branching structure where you sort of have two points and then three pairs of edges going out from them in different directions, and then those are alternating with hexagons through the graph, and those are going off to infinity. And I've already marked in this picture a subspace F of the end completion of this graph, and suggestively I'm going to call the set of those ends which are contained in the set F psi. Okay. F is this marked subspace of the graph. So that means in each of these modules where we've got two points and then three pairs of edges branching out in three different directions, we take all the edges to be in F. In each of these hexagons, we take somehow these three outer edges to be in F. And then at infinity, we take some set psi of the ends of this graph. Okay. And now let's think about what it might mean to build a path through the subspace F in this graph from the vertex U here at the bottom to the vertex V. Okay, what should such a path do? Well, let's just look in this small part of the graph first of all. You have to go up this edge and up this edge, and then you make a choice. Either you go up here and then round there somehow and down here, or you go up here, round there, down here. Let's say you decide to go this way around. Then you come to this hexagon. How can you get from here to here? Well, you certainly have to go up there. Then you're going to have to get across here somehow, come down here, across here, and then back this way. Right. And now we're back in both of these two subgraphs in the same situation as before. We have to make some decision about which way we want to branch. And then again, we come to these hexagons where we have to branch both ways. And we'd like to do this. Okay. So first, I should say this builds now some subtree of the binary tree over which this has been structured. And we want to build this subtree in such a way that at odd-numbered layers, so starting with the first layer here, you branch just one way, and at even-numbered layers, you branch both ways. And we also want that when you follow some ray through this subtree off to infinity, that the end that you reach is in the set psi, because we'd like to use that point at infinity on our path. So what this means is that having a path from U to V is like having a winning strategy for player one in the game Gamma 2 of Psi. Right, because this strategy is exactly given by such a subtree. It branches just one way at the first step, telling you which move you should make, and branches both ways at the even-numbered steps because your opponent can choose a move in either direction. And then you want the final sequence to be in the set psi. Good. We could also think about what it would mean to have U and V be in different topological components of the set F. Right? What would that look like? So if they're going to be in different components, let's say U is in the yellow component, and V, oh no, brown is not good. That's not clear. Maybe V is in the purple component. Yes. Then we also know that all of these guys have to go in the yellow component, and all of these guys in the purple component. So now if we're deciding on our components, then in this subtree, we still have to split into two components in such a way that these two vertices end up on opposite sides. So now these guys have to be in the yellow component, these guys in the purple component, and here we can decide which component these go into. Let's put them in the yellow component. Well then, now we don't have to worry about this subgraph over here because we're putting these two in the same component. Let's just color that all yellow. But here we still have two points that are supposed to be in opposite components. So once more, we look up here, and again here we have to branch both ways because in both of these subgraphs, we're forced to put these two vertices into different components. And so, by a similar argument to the one we had before, we get that U and V are in different components, if they're in different components, then you have a winning strategy now for player two. In gamma 2 of psi. Right. And so determinacy of gamma 2 of psi becomes the principle that if U and V are in the same connected component of this set F, then there's a path from U to V. Right. But we saw earlier, or I claimed earlier, that there are sets which are, there are sets psi for which gamma 2 of psi is not determined. And now if we take psi to be such a set, then there's no winning strategy for either player, which means U and V are in the same connected component, but they're not joined by a path. And now if we take the connected component containing them as our set, that's a set which is connected but not path connected in the graph. Yes?
Just one clarification. So each player has one of these trees, or are both players playing in the same tree?
Oh.
So that would be like a tree for player one, right?
So what I showed was that finding a path is like finding a particular kind of tree.
Yeah.
And that kind of tree corresponds to a winning strategy for player one.
So, for example, player one would have this tree and player two would have another one.
Well, the thing is, this the first kind of tree corresponds to a winning strategy for the first player.
Okay, yeah.
And the second kind of tree corresponds to a winning strategy for the second player in the same game.
But they're not both starting like one starting at U, the other one at V, and playing in the same tree?
No.
Okay.
The game we're considering is just this game where you pick a sequence of of numbers sort of which are all 0 or 1. So the first player says 0 or 1, or maybe left or right.
Yeah.
Second player says left or right.
Okay.
And so on
through the tree. Thank you.
So does this mean that under AD, this conjecture would be true?
That means that under AD... let me... That's exactly what I now want to talk about. Yes. So what this shows is that under not AD, this conjecture is false. Right? That's what we've established here. But this construction, I mean, this particular graph looks very carefully put together so that the structure of the graph is encoding the game that we want for the determinacy, right? And so you might think this is not really such a strong link to determinacy principles from this graph theory because it's only for this carefully constructed graph. But in fact, it turns out that if you have AD, then in any locally finite graph, you get that any subset which is connected is already path connected. And that this link between determinacy and deducing path connectedness from connectedness just holds in arbitrary graphs, however they're structured. And in order to explain how that happens, I think I can only really give a sketch of the argument in a simplified case. But first of all, we need the principle that if you have a locally finite graph, then you can cut it up into finite blobs, some tree of finite blobs, maybe some going off towards infinity, such that all the overlap sets are disjoint, all the blobs are, as I said, finite and connected, and such that this tree displays the collection of ends of the graph in the sense that the rays through this tree precisely correspond to the ends of the graph. And now, to explain what's happening here, I want to work in a simplified case where each of these overlaps just contains two vertices, two points of the graph. The argument in general is similar but more complicated, and I think all the ideas are already there in this case. Okay, so now we could consider what it means to have a path in some subspace F. Let's say here's F, and again, F has some set psi of n's in it. So to have a path through F joining two vertices U and V. And without loss of generality, we can assume that U and V both live in the same blob of the graph here at the bottom. And now, how can we encode the idea of finding a path from U to V as a game? We encode it as the so-called path-building game, which is played between two players, Peter and Catherine. Peter wants to show that there is a path from U to V in the graph, and Catherine wants to prevent Peter from doing this. So Peter, first of all, should explain how this path might look in this first finite blob containing U and V. So Peter says, right, it goes to this vertex, does something over there, and comes back out here, goes across to this vertex, does something up there, comes back here, and then comes back down to V. And Catherine then thinks, okay, in providing this description of the path, Peter has implicitly claimed that he can now build a path from here to here in this graph up here, and a path from here to here in this graph. So Catherine now challenges one of these claims. Catherine says, maybe on this edge, there is no way to continue the path. And Peter says, well, I could continue it a little bit further. At least through this blob, I could get it to there. And then again, Catherine has to challenge. And they carry on in this way through the graph, Peter building up bigger and bigger parts of the path. And if this continues forever, then eventually they've built some ray through the tree, which goes off to some end. And then Peter wins if the end that they reach is in the set psi, and otherwise Catherine wins. So I hope it's clear that in order to build a path from U to V, what you need is a winning strategy for Peter. Strategy for Peter in the path building game. Good. And what would it mean to analyze with a game the idea that that these two points are in different components of F? Well, we analyze that with the so-called cut-building game, again, played between Peter and Catherine. Now, Catherine is trying to build partial witnesses to some cut, which shows that U and V are in different components of F. And Peter is trying to prevent her from doing this. So once more, Catherine starts by saying how things should look in this finite part. She says, well, maybe these vertices lie in the same component as U, and these vertices lie in the same component as V. And now Peter looks, and for a pair of vertices which Catherine put in the same component, she's not really claiming to be able to do anything more beyond that point. But for a pair of vertices which Catherine put into different components, she's implicitly claiming that she can now continue building this this separation, this cut, beyond this point. And so Peter challenges at one such edge. That's the kind of move Peter can now make. And then Catherine continues her description of the cut. Peter is once more allowed to challenge. And they continue in this way, possibly ad infinitum. If they do continue forever, then Peter will win if the end that they reach after infinitely many moves is in the set psi, and otherwise Catherine will win. And now I hope, again, that it's clear that having U and V in different components is witnessed by having a winning strategy for Catherine in the cut building game. So therefore, to get at the idea that if this thing is connected, then it's path connected, we need somehow to relate these two games. In fact, if we want to apply a determinacy principle to do this, we need a statement something like, if Catherine has a winning strategy in the path building game, then she also has a winning strategy in the cut building game. Because then we could apply determinacy in the path building game. Either we get a winning strategy for Peter there, which gives us a path, or we get a winning strategy for Catherine there, but then that will witness that our two vertices are in different components by giving us also a winning strategy in the cut building game. Right. So the question is, suppose that Catherine has a winning strategy in the path building game. She can always successfully keep challenging Peter's attempts to build a path, so that eventually when they get to infinity, they reach an end which isn't in psi. How does she now build a winning strategy in the cut building game? How should she play so as to win in the cut building game? So this seems a little odd, because here in this bottom blob, Catherine is supposed to begin by giving a division of these vertices into two parts, some sort of suitable cut down here. And the only information she can use to do this is information about where she challenges Peter in the path building game. But what she does is this. She considers the following graph. So first of all, she looks at those edges, which are in the set F. And in addition, she sticks in some new edges, joining each pair of vertices here on the outside with the property that there is no possible move by Peter, no possible path from U to V, such that this would be the end where she would challenge in her winning strategy. Okay, she leaves the ones where she might challenge, but she adds an extra edge anywhere where she'll never challenge. And now it's clear that in this graph, there is no path from U to V, going only along these red edges. Because if there were such a path, because Catherine has a winning strategy, she could challenge it somewhere. I've drawn it through the wrong kind of edge. Right. If there were such a path, then Catherine could challenge it somewhere. But the only edges it's allowed to use are the ones where Catherine never challenges. Okay. So we can now take, as Catherine's partition, on this side, the path component of U in that red subgraph, and on the other side, all the remaining vertices. And now Peter challenges somewhere, and Catherine once more has to find some cut up in this next blob. Right. And how does she now move on to this next blob? Well, she knows that this edge where Peter challenged was not one of the ones she added as a red edge to the graph. So this is an edge with the property that there is some path that Peter might have added on which she would have challenged in the path building game. And now as she goes along, she imagines an auxiliary play through the path building game. So now she imagines that Peter played this path here and that she challenged here. And now once more, she looks at the possible moves that Peter might make up here. She looks at the edges where she'll never challenge, and she adds new edges there. And once more, there can't be a path from here across to here, only going through the edges in F. and those new edges, and so once more she can partition. This guy, and again Peter challenges, and once more wherever Peter challenges, she can imagine in her auxiliary version of the game that Peter had played some path up there and that she'd made exactly that challenge. Right. And now they keep on playing forever through this graph. And Catherine knows that her strategy is winning in the path-building game. So in this auxiliary play, going off to infinity through the path-building game, because Catherine wins, the end that it goes to can't be in the set psi. Okay, but that's exactly the same end that was arrived at through this actual play in the cut building game. And so the end that they've gone off to is not in the set psi, and that means that Catherine wins. So this gives a winning strategy in the cut building game. And now, if we have determinacy for the path building game, then we get, as I sketched earlier, that U and V are in the same connected component precisely when they're joined by a path. And that means that we can salvage the following theorem, that if you have a connected Borel subspace of the topological space that you build from a graph, then this space will be path connected. Right. So for this, you need this Borel determinacy principle. If you allow yourself maybe some large cardinal axioms, then you can have stronger determinacy principles, and so you can have stronger statements about topological infinite graph theory until, as you were saying, if you assume the full axiom of determinacy, which is the statement that every game of this type is determined, then you get that every subspace is path connected. Right. Now, the people who came up with these questions and who were asking about these subspaces are not set theorists. I know them, and they are in some sense dismissive towards set theory and towards certain foundational issues. Nevertheless, in their work, this fundamental lemma for their constructions relies on this odd determinacy statement, which seemed like some weird just set theoretic phenomenon that lies off in the very high rank sets that aren't relevant, so we thought, for mathematics. And what this means is that in a type theoretic foundation of the type that we've been discussing here, you can't get this. And there are various attitudes that you might take towards this fact. And I want to close by discussing just a couple of possible attitudes. So one attitude would be to say, yeah, good riddance to bad rubbish. If you can't formalize it in type theory, then it's not really mathematics. But I think this is a silly attitude. I think it's sort of obvious that these arguments really are mathematics, at least as she is practiced by mathematicians. And so we can't just say, no, we should ignore this stuff. Another attitude would be to say, very well, so much the worse for type theory. You can't formalize this in type theory, so you can't take type theory as your foundation. Again, I think this would be a silly attitude. I think you can say, look, so to explain why I think that would be a silly attitude, I should first say that I think it's important to keep track of what you can do where, and to say, yes, this is a sort of thing that you can do in a set theoretic foundation, maybe not in a standard type theoretic one. But also, one of the advantages of the of a type theoretic foundation would be its modular character. That is to say, you can somehow build up your type theory and say, well, you have various type theories where you have different sorts of type constructors, and you need these constructors to do this bit of mathematics, and maybe you want these if you're going to do this kind of mathematics, right? I mean, my browser on my computer, I have add-ons if I want it to do particular kinds of things, and similarly here you have sort of add-ons which let you do particular kinds of mathematics, and maybe you could say, right, we need to look at whether there is some add-ons which then let us do this sort of thing, which obviously is mathematics within a suitably extended foundation. And I was asking Bas Spitters about what might be some sort of add-ons that you would need. And he was saying, well, maybe what you need is a principle called induction-induction, which I get the impression is not very strong, and maybe a weak form of it follows from having W types already. And that would be enough if you're prepared to swallow the principle of the excluded middle, because then you get sort of all kinds of things coming in. But I mean, perhaps you can also get away with something weaker, which just captures the kinds of reasoning that you need for this, perhaps with some suitably formulated determinacy principle. Okay, so I've suggested what I think are two silly and one sensible attitude to this sort of issue, but I would be interested to hear what your attitudes are to this. Thank you.
So thank you very much for the discussion. So we have 5 minutes for discussion, and maybe there's already the first question.
Yes, you could just assume this theorem as an axiom and type theory and do mathematics with it and not care about the status of this theorem at all.
Yes, that's right. That would be an option. I think you can see why people would be unhappy with that option.
So the reason people are usually unhappy about axioms and type theory is that they break the computation, but since there is not going to be ever any hope for this being, it's not an effective theorem ever, then that's okay, I think.
I meant why the graph theorists would be unhappy, right? I mean, suppose they say, right, we move across, we work in the type theoretic foundation, and now we need some statement which, let's have the following idea to get this statement, add it as a new axiom to the topic.
Well, but from what I understood, the graph theorists, they just wanna trust that this theorem could be proved or could be justified by some principles, and then they wanna go on doing graph theory. So I think they wouldn't mind, you know, admitting this as a fact to do what they want to use it for. And that you could do in type theory, presumably.
There we get into questions of their psychology, so let's move on to a different
one. Yeah, to Thorsten.
Okay. Somehow, I mean, you presented yourself a naive justification, and the question is, how can it be translated into foundations, right? And my impression is, and I don't know whether that applies here, is when you go the constructive way, you often have to revise the structures you play with. I mean, for example, topology, it looks quite different in a constructive or type theoretic setting.
Yes.
It's a point free, or some people say point less, yeah, if a bit cynical, but anyway. So I don't know what happens, but it seemed to me if we, I mean, since there seemed to be a reasonable argument here, then it should be possible to do this in type theory by revisiting and making explicit the constructive nature of this argument.
Yes, that's something I didn't mention, but of course you would have to reformulate all the statements here carefully and properly in a constructive fashion.
This is extra work, yeah?
Yeah.
But hang on, we are doing science, yeah? We should rejoice, yeah? Like, oh, we have some problem, yeah? But actually, I think something comes out of this. So my experience is, and there a nice example, I think, was this graph minor problem was mentioned, that a constructive analysis brings you additional insight about the construction, yeah? So yes. To me, sometimes classical mathematics is like looking from far, and it's sometimes good to find ideas, yeah? But when you go closer, then it's good to do a more constructive style of reasoning.
Yes, thank you.
So Buchholz?
I was a little bit unsure what you meant that it couldn't be done in type theory. You just mean type theory without any axioms. But of course, this is all very classical. So you would, of course, assume excluded middle. And that already gives you a lot of power. And I mean, you could assume determinacy if you wanted to. That's another axiom. I mean, once you don't care about whether you can extract programs, I mean, that's fine. So can you elaborate on what you meant by it couldn't be done in type theory? You just meant it was not constructive, but is it constructive in a set theoretic sense, in a sense of constructive set theories?
Yeah, I guess what I meant was that, I mean, so there are lots of examples of statements where you say, look, here you use the axiom of choice, and so we're not going to use that in type theory. This is some horribly non-constructive.
You could just assume the axiom of choice for those parts and then work in the setting of the axiom of choice.
That's right. This is what I was saying about modularity, right? You can put on modules which let you do extra stuff, and somehow a maximal module would be to add the axiom of choice, and then then you're just back to a normal foundation, essentially.
Well, you're back to where the sets are the normal sets, but you also have these groupoids hanging about, and you could, yeah.
Yes, I agree. But I mean, with an argument like this, which doesn't seem like it's relying on massive amounts of choice or, I mean, massive amounts of excluded middle, I think you would hope that with a suitable formulation, you would be able to get at what's going on here with much simpler and less proof theoretically strong modules.
Oh yeah, I love this kind of work, and I love what Thorsten was suggesting, trying to rework it in the constructive, find the constructive core of it, the most beautiful constructive statement. But even if you just want it as stated, you probably proved it with excluded middle. So if you want to formalize that argument in type theory, you are free to do so by assuming excluded middle, right?
Right, but somehow a project within type theoretic foundations is taking those arguments which can be formulated without excluded middle and doing so. And what I'm saying is here you have apparently a new kind of problem for that, namely that you have an argument which relies on sets very high up in the set theoretic hierarchy, right? And you can make it as an axiom the principle that you wanted to deduce from that, namely Borel determinacy. And that would probably resolve it, but it feels a little unsatisfactory. But I'm not sure I have a more satisfactory suggestion.